Now let me tell you the one and only reason you need for getting a delusion instead of a vision. And it's that delusions aren't eyes. Yes, eyes as in eyes. Unlike visions, delusions don't have that sussy weird lore and therefore have zero relation to Celestia. Want more? Well, what about delusions produced today are far better than the manga and are as polished as a gnosis fresh from Venti's stomach. What's better is that delusions can be had by merely showing off your efforts and not through some ambition or random untold detail. Thanks, A. Now, unless you want to be part of some unknown god's plan for a dystopian world and still be nuked just by saying the words Fanes or Primordial One. First and foremost, delusions are the product of what we call Archon residue that is either injected directly into a person's bloodstream or infused into catalysts that become a focus for channeling its weird powers. The effects will vary, however, depending on the user in question and what type of delusion they possess. I say this because we have multiple cases of characters experiencing completely different effects and are able to do completely different things depending on their delusion. I say delusion and people separately because depending on both factors, we can have totally different effects. Number one, you can have rapid aging caused by fake delusion using a dead serpent god's juju. Number two, you can have someone die without a possible cause from either using their delusion too much or just by using it once. Number three, you can have relatively normal people wielding delusions with basically no physical or possibly mental problems whatsoever. And lastly, you can have a person end up with semi-schizophrenic tendencies from having demon bathwater injected directly into them. And I mean directly into a person's body without care or precaution. We see this sort of process in great detail from the Genshin manga using Collei or Collei as a test subject for the so-called Archon residue. Granted, the object used to inject Collei or Collei looks very similar to the mist pollen wick, but we will not assume that it is what it looks like. What we will assume is that delusions and whatever was injected into Collei is Archon residue, with the word Archon being a very vague and widely described word. The Chinese script for Archon residue was and still is called Demon God residue. What was failed to be mentioned here is that this Demon God residue is specifically used on Collei only. Because remember, Collei in the story became a test subject of Barnabas, which is this guy. And being a test subject, she is subjected to possibly multiple other injections as well as being a subject for that specific demon god residue. Even if you say that Collei was injected with mist pollen from Sissons, then that further improves upon my point that Barnabas and possibly even the Fatui aren't just using gods or demons, and that delusions can be made from multiple materials. Sissons, for example, if translated to Latin, means firefly, along with their archive descriptions being described as little creatures. So there is no mention of them being gods or anything. But what they do have is elemental residue. And if I were a mad scientist, I'd include anything with elemental residue into my numerous experiments. For example, if I was Dottore or Barnabas, and I was given 100 test subjects, I would first test 100 random residues from 100 random creatures, demons, gods, beings, or whatever I want to use. And after using 100 residues on 100 subjects, I would then use whatever works and make a more polished, refined form of that residue to improve my project. Trial and error is what they are doing to find the perfect delusion. If you were a mad scientist and Saritza told you to do experiments however you want, wouldn't you also be spoiled for choices? And let's not fail to mention that the Saritza herself is also a god or maybe a demon god. Not only that, all seven Archons are considered gods, and the Fatui are known to take their gnoses as an objective. So wouldn't you wonder then what might happen if we use those gnoses, or possibly Archon juice, for making our so-called residue? We'll go back to Saritza residue later, but for now let's talk about people with recorded delusions. So, as we approach the point of no return, let's discuss what and who the Fatui have been harvesting their quote-unquote residue from. First, the Genshin manga has two forms of delusions in detail, or as much detail as I can find. Keep in mind, these events happened prior to the events in-game. and the next proper delusions that they might have made are already better versions of their sussy prototype counterparts. Having said that, these two delusions are from Collei and Crepus. We've pretty much discussed Collei's reason for having a delusion. She's a guinea pig of Barnabas, and the effects of the prototype delusion injected into her shows the effects that you see while reading. In summary, its main feature includes a serpent-like black ghost, as well as other black figures that speak to whoever its host is. Its side effects include weird voices, fake scenarios in her head, huge anxiety, and possibly an enhanced rate of PTSD from previous events. She also gets sensations of being under the water while a dark voice from within her starts gnawing at her thoughts. The weird black snake also seems to love it when Collei embraces their bidding and allows her to use those powers. In fact, they want her to rely on them for almost everything. She did have it removed or exorcised by Sino in the end, however. But that's the extent of the effects that she experiences, as well as the setbacks of what happens when you inject yourself with raw Archon residue. Remember, Collei is a test subject, quote-unquote test subject, so the effects of the residue on her aren't as polished or as focused compared to our next guinea pig. Here we have Diluc's daddy-doo, Crepus, who obtained a delusion called the Evil Eye from an unknown origin. Short story, he uses this delusion when they were attacked by Ursa the Drake, by which it backfires on Crepus and mortally wounds him. Whether or not this is the first time, or it happened every time he used it in his lifetime, or even the fact that he used it at all is still shrouded in mystery. So after using his delusion and driving away Ursa the Drake, Crepus dies and Diluc is left with the delusion. Remember that Diluc already had a vision a few years prior. The delusion itself, however, Evil Eye, didn't mention the effects that Collei had experienced. But the effect backfiring never occurred on Diluc when he used it. And the main reason speculated is that Diluc never got affected by this delusion because he was a vision bearer. The other is that Diluc used it without spewing black flames compared to Crepus when he was fighting Ursa the Drake. The moment Diluc did use the black flames only happened once in his time using it, and it was merely used to show off as the Blackfire incident's culprit. More subjective reason was that his ideals and motivations aligned with whatever the residue was used on the Evil Eye. But these three are still speculations as to why Diluc is nearly unaffected. But think about it, if visions require ambition and some other thing to be bestowed, then maybe to use a delusion, we need to just align what we want with whatever the residue wants, or just don't use such excessive amounts like what happened to Crepus. This is still a vague idea and cannot be backed up, since Collei's is raw residue injected right into her versus Crepus's evil eye infused into an item. Not to mention, the next form of delusions don't have certain demons whispering and only have one side effect, and that is rapid aging. As we have known, Scaramouche and the Fatui were the reason for Crystal Marrow booming in Inazuma, and they are also the reason for handing out free delusions, or selling delusions just like candy. But why Crystal Marrow, you ask? Because Crystal Marrow grows from the bones of the Tataragami serpent, Orobashi, and the Orobashi's lingering power is what is inside of that Crystal Marrow. This delusion, however, only comes from the Orobashi, so both positive and negative effects only come from the Crystal Marrow itself, well, as far as we know of, unless the Fatui put something else in there that affects their age. But technically speaking, the effect of rapid aging only occurs on delusions made from Orobashi's remains, or delusions that were given to the soldiers of Watatsumi. If you're wondering, why does the Orobashi emit this weird power, and why does Crystal Marrow have anything to do with the Orobashi's powers? Well then, Timmy, that's why we call it Tataragami. See, Tataragami is, and I quote, a divine being that dies and the phenomena that they create. You could also say any divine being and the phenomena that they create when they die. This means that when divine beings die, they are bound to create a certain phenomena depending on the divine being. And this energy or power that lingers is one of the things we're looking for when making our Archon residue. Divine beings creating phenomena include Havria, who blew up into salt, Orobashi, who, you know, and the Thunderbird, Kapatsir or Kapatsir, who died on Seirai Island. You can include Durin's corruption on Dragonspine if you want, but yeah, divine beings and the phenomena they create when they die. Something you might bring up is Makoto and the God of Woods. The God of Woods so far has no information on how he died. And Makoto, in a way, did not completely die in Kanria. She had some form of ability to manifest her consciousness into objects, and managed to mess up the timeline by planting her consciousness in a fabricated tree at the Narukami Shrine. Maybe that's how her energy was used when she died? Or that was planned all along? I don't know. Regardless, we know next to none about both the God of Woods and Makoto's moments before and after their deaths. Now I hope you are still watching, because here's where we can get better delusions that don't backfire or have some weird side effects when used. And all of these delusions are being used by the Fatui themselves. See, get where I'm going at? The next and final delusions we have are from Harbingers, the Fatui Agents, the Sisson Mages, and the Mirror Maidens, which are part of the main force of the Fatui. Now why would the main force of the Fatui not have any problems whatsoever when using a delusion? Now I speculate that the Archon residue used is from either the Cryo Archon Saritsa herself, the Gnoses that she has, as well as the other Gnoses that they keep taking, or the delusions that they have right now are just the best that it could be. I mean, you gotta wonder why they translated it to Archon residue anyway, right? Think about it, if you had 11 powerful Harbingers as well as a huge army on your back, why would you give them delusions that have setbacks? If any, maybe place some sort of tracker on it, so you know where they are. But for the Harbingers, we don't really know if all of them have delusions, hence Scaramouche and why we can't find him for some reason. These refined delusions are far better than the mass-produced candy from Inazuma, or the prototype juices that were injected into Collei, and that black market wonky gauntlet used by Crepus. And these delusions might be refined to the point where they don't affect the user negatively at all. I mean, you're making an army of super soldiers, right? Why give them bad ones when you already have the good ones? Some of these delusions were even used to alleviate the raw elemental powers that's gone haywire. And here's where we also see someone who has a delusion but no clear vision, literally speaking. Case in point, Rosaline Kruchka Lohefwalter. I hope I didn't butcher that. Whose delusion was made to quell the raging flames that she transformed herself into. Something you should be aware of is that Senora does not have a proper vision. Her pyro abilities don't come from her delusion either, of which her delusion is Cryo, given to her by Piero, the first of the 11 Harbingers. Now technically, and based on past delusions that I've mentioned before, Senora's delusion should impact her in some sort of negative way. But to her, the delusion that she has is anything but negative. Senora's delusion is a way for her to suppress the raw pyro element that she emits, as well as to forget her past. And that past is Rostam's death in the Cataclysm. If you don't know who Rostam is, she basically likes him, and he died. And his death is the cause for Senora, or Rosaline, to turn herself into that form, because that Pyro Moth Queen form is her true form after she sacrificed herself to become the embodiment of liquid fire. Now what is liquid fire? Where have I heard this before? Where have I seen that before? Oh yes, that's right! It's from the Pyro artifact! Now what pyro liquid is only known by Senora, as well as the knowledge of how to use it. No other person has written context about liquid fire. So no, Alice, Mona, Lisa, and other known scholars and great mages, as well as possibly archons, don't count yet. But we see the capabilities of liquid fire when used at such great levels, as well as the ability of delusions to suppress certain effects. But this only works for Senora specifically. It's nearly clear, however, that there aren't any bad side effects that hurt Senora physically or mentally. Next, we have Tartaglia, or Tartaglia, who is effectively the luckiest and most overkill character in the game. The only thing left for this guy is if he actually got the Gnosis from Zhongli. Anyway, as we know so far, his delusion was given to him after he gained his foul legacy power from the Abyss. However, his delusion came possibly after his delusion, but how he got it is still a mystery. Some speculations say that he learned his waterbending abilities when he learned to traverse the abyss. But this is more or less debatable due to his behavior when he returned home, as well as having no mention of his vision in his entire character lore. His thirst for battle and bloodthirsty behavior doesn't come from his delusion either. It came from his experience from the abyss. And there is also no mention of his delusion affecting him mentally and physically. He only thought of his delusion and vision, as well as his powers from the abyss, as something that can make him stronger. One thing is for sure, is that his delusion doesn't have any backfires or setbacks when he uses it. Now what if you're not a playable character in Genshin? What if you just end up as an NPC? Well, some normal people of the Fatui have delusions, if you call them normal. We've seen Harbingers without visions but have delusions, and ones that have both in their arsenal. What about the lesser and lower branches of the Fatui? Well, to me, you're in luck because we've encountered multiple instances of Fatui agents and Sisson mages throughout the game, and they all wield delusions without having a vision first, unless you call these things visions. Mind you, these less unique characters are mostly backed up by non-voiced quests. Fatui agents and Sisson mages act and talk the same way normal NPCs do in-game, minus the fact that they have to speak in such a convoluted code to the point where you would smash some plates, if you know what I mean. But other than that, they all speak and interact pretty normally to each other. No weird voices in their head, no psycho mantis controlling them, no crazy dialogue like we would expect since they're delusion holders, and no rapid aging either. If anything, the Fatui members seem to age pretty slowly. Members like Katarina, Collei, and the skirmishers that we met in the chasm say that they've been there for a very long time. Some of them even decided to run and hide or chase one another by going deeper into the chasm. And the earliest we know from them being there was when Liwe and Seznaya were working together in the chasm. Whether or not this was 2,000 years ago when the star fell into the Lishang region, or 500 years ago when the cataclysm occurred, but a minimum of 500 or at least 50 or 100 years without much physical or mental change is still a great feat compared to the usual citizens of a lot of the regions. Mirror Maidens, however, are still in the dark, and we only have vague descriptions to go over, which are not as accurate as they would seem, since we meet Sisson mages who don't sound like they're gone in the head looking for some duty, quote-unquote, or pyro agents obsessed with paying debts. If anything, some of them are obsessed with making money, so we'll leave the Mirror Maidens as is for lack of interactions and information. What's more is that we'll likely see more of these delusion-wielding characters with possibly even less backfires, better positives, and more info on delusions and the Fatui. Okay, now that I've finished saying every possible factor and every person with a delusion, we've now gathered every reason why delusions don't backfire and would be a good option over visions. Along with that, we can also find out how you can get a special delusion that has no side effects. First, don't be a guinea pig test subject. This one's pretty obvious because Collei only had those things speak in her head because she was directly injected with Archon residue. Other than that, Archon residue itself was raw fluid and possibly unrefined. Second, never buy or ask for any vision-looking trinkets from the black market or possibly from random sussy people, because chances are they're fake, duped, or just plain sus. And I'm talking about Crepus's delusion, of which no one knew where it came from and was but a trinket of unknown origin. Even if it was from the Fatui, the fact that it wasn't the Fatui themselves who gave it or was present when they gave it is a bad sign already. I mean, who knows where Crepus got the evil eye? Third, make sure you're in the Fatui. You don't really need to have a vision to get into the Fatui. What you will need, however, is to be as crazy and indifferent as every single member of their order. You also need a bit more combat experience than normal, unless you want to be a skirmisher or a regular Fatui NPC like these guys. So get those combat points up and be as determined yet careless and reckless as the Harbingers themselves. Fourth and finally, this technique can slingshot you to having the top delusions easily, and that is to be noticed by the Harbingers, or if you're that good, the Tsaritsa herself. Be sure to be noticed for something that helps the Fatui in some way, okay? And not for something stupid. But who knows, that stupid thing might be crazy enough for them to let you in. Sadly, something not all of us can do. But if you do get noticed, then you're probably on your way there, or you're probably too rich, powerful, smart, or idealistic that you don't need a delusion anyway. Or you already have a vision and you just got in. Or you were possibly a child who had some experience in the abyss. It sounds pretty hard to do, but it's not hard as getting a vision. Because with a delusion, you have a way of increasing your chances, instead of waiting till something happens to your life that you get a vision. Something I'm saving for anyone who watched up to this point is a warning to delusion wanters. For a delusion, you need to be in line with Tsaritsa's ideals and the ideals of Sneznaya as a whole. If not Tsaritsa, then for your own selfish reasons. Remember, nobody cares how many bodies are piled up and how many people sacrificed their lives. All that matters to the Fatui and Sneznaya is that all is done in preparation for the final battle, where everyone is destined to fight in. And that battle is going to be endless and very, very dark. Probably as dark as the abyss. So would you dare trade your freedom to serve an uncaring god and work for her uncaring servants and nations? Are you willing to look at the bigger picture and do what must be done for the greater good of the Tsaritsa's plan? Would you wait eagerly until the so-called gods of Celestia bestow your vision? Or would you fight for reasons that are far more selfish than yours, only to be given a delusion? Now, I'd like to take this bit at the end and say thanks for 1,000 subscribers and for letting me get this far with my channel. I never really would have made it without you guys commenting and showing your opinions, and it gives me a lot of energy to make more videos whenever you guys comment. Also, big thanks to everyone at Honey Hunter's Discord for always being there to answer my random questions. And with that, I'll leave you guys by saying, leave a like, subscribe, and hit the bell, and of course, comment below what you guys think of my new video. This took quite some time to do because I had to be as sure as I can, as well as finding some good topics to talk about, but it was all worth it. So I'll see you guys in the next video, yeah? Bye!